In recent days, the lobby at Boston Medical Center has been home not just to patients waiting to see a doctor, but to dozens of Haitian migrants in need of somewhere to stay. Refugees from Haiti have been arriving at the hospital since the fall of 2021. But officials with BMC report the number of homeless refugees seeking shelter there has risen dramatically in recent weeks as the country, which humanitarian groups say is on the brink of civil war, faces escalating gang violence, food and job shortages, and barriers to accessing medical care. BMC has been scrambling to provide these migrants with food, shelter, and other basic needs, along with city and state officials and advocacy groups, including the Immigrant Family Services Institute. Officials have been able to find places to stay for many migrants who have come to the hospital, but with more people fleeing Haiti every day, the struggle to find shelter continues, as does the strain on the hospital. I'm joined now by that executive director of the Immigrant Family Services Institute, Dr. Geralde Gabeau, and Jeff Thielman, president and CEO of the International Institute of New England, which supports immigrants and refugees in the region. Thank you both so much for joining us.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Dr. Gabeau, can we start with you? Can you describe for us the situation in Haiti right now, and what is it that people are fleeing there?
So basically, right now, the situation is impossible for people to live in Haiti with gang violence and interruption at all levels. Basically, there is a lack of leadership. Government cannot do anything. The country is run by gangs, and people cannot go to schools. You know, they cannot go to their job. Even access to hospital to care is impossible. And that's one of the reasons why I continue to say, as long as the situation persists the way it is in Haiti, we have to be ready to welcome them, because they don't have any other choice than to leave, because the situation is definitely dire right now.
Well, Jeff, it sounds like we're not ready to greet them. What are the challenges that these migrants are facing when they're getting here to Boston?
Well, the challenges are many. First of all, the big challenge, as Dr. Gabeau said, is to find housing. The challenge is to help them find jobs if they're eligible for jobs. A big challenge for many people is they're paroled into the country for a short period of time. Some cases, their status is iffy. And so getting them employer authorization documents is something our organization does. In partnership with Dr. Gabeau's organization, we enroll people in public benefits, health care here in Massachusetts, cash assistance, which is offered by the federal government to certain people in certain statuses. We enroll them in food stamps. We enroll them in transitional assistance. So we do what we can to help them get started in the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. And then we also will help them find jobs if they're eligible to work.
Why are they winding up in the emergency room?
There's no other place for them to go. So everybody's situation and story is a little bit different. Some of the stories we're hearing is that they arrive here, they've got a friend in Boston or in the Boston area, they might stay with them for a day or two, or they might get there and there's no place for them to go, and so they go to Boston Medical Center and then they stay there. You have to understand, Boston or Eastern Massachusetts has the third largest concentration of Haitians outside of Haiti. Right. Largest is Miami, second largest is New York, we're in third place. Lots of people want to come here. They know there are jobs here, they know there are good schools here, and they have friends and family here, or people they may know or know of, and so they want to come to this area.
Dr. Gabeau, I understand, are some of these migrants winding up at your office as well? I understand that some of them are staying there. What's it been like there?
So, I mean, since last year, we've been the entry point for new migrants. Whenever they arrive from the airport, basically, they come directly to our office. So last year, when we had the same crisis at Boston Medical Center, we were very involved in making sure that we talk to landlord, and then we even sign up a list on our own name to place family in housing. And we have a large network of friends, of churches. We always try to find a solution, but we reach a point where without resources, it's impossible for us to continue like this. And that's the reason why it's heavy on us, because we have so much to do with so little. And that's the reason why we hear a lot about the crisis. But last year, because we were able to intervene and quickly, we didn't feel that the heat the same way. So that's where we are calling on everyone to step up, because we need to be ready. We cannot turn our back toward those who are fleeing, you know, difficult conditions and come here to find it worse than what they left behind. So that's one of the reasons why I'm calling on everyone. Let's step up, let's do it. We can do it and we should do it.
And I understand that the migrants who were at Boston Medical Center have, they found homes for those who were sleeping there, But we're, as you said, we're not done with this, right? This is going to continue. No. There are more people coming. You're asking yes. people to step up. Are they doing it? What do you need them to do in order to step up?
So first, we need to step the federal government to act in terms of, you know, providing resources to state, to cities, and to organizations like us, so that we can find the resources to do the work that we are doing. We are also asking people to open up their hearts and their homes, because we saw with different groups, a lot of people did step up. They did help other groups who are here, you know, in terms of providing housing. People have a spare room, they have a basement. They open up their hearts to people. But we find it a little bit more challenging when it comes to the Haitians. We don't feel the same level of enthusiasm, the same level of people wanting to step up to help. And that's the reason why we said we need to step up, because, again, those are human beings fleeing really difficult situations. They are here, and they want to contribute to their community. They want to help. So the least we can do is to provide them with the housing that they need so that they can go work, contribute to the community, help themselves, and help our community.
Yeah, I mean, we've heard a lot of talk about Ukrainian refugees, and there's some extraordinary steps that were taken to welcome Ukrainian refugees into this country. Are you seeing a notable difference between how these groups are being treated?
Yeah, it's a world of difference in terms of the way that Haitian migrants are being treated compared to other groups. Again, we are open, we want to help everyone. But when we see this magnitude of difference between the way Haitians are treated compared to other groups, it hurts us. It, you know, pains us to see that when we're talking about systemic racism in this country, it goes so far even to close our doors to the less fortunate among us. And that's a shame. That's a shame for our country. And I said, we need to do better.
Jeff, have you seen other groups of migrants that are dealing with the same kind of challenges, or is this unique?
Yeah, so we have about 5,000 total people in services right now at the International Institute of New England. That includes Afghans who fought by the side of American soldiers in the war in Afghanistan, Ukrainians who fled the conflict in Ukraine, and we have 2,030 Haitians, many of them referred by IFSI, by Dr. Gabeau's group, to our organization in services right now. And the difference in funding available to Ukrainians, between Ukrainians, Afghans, and Haitians is significant. So the Haitians are not getting the same sort of federal assistance that Ukrainians got or that Afghans got. I will say this, the state legislature in Massachusetts passed a bill last year that funded something called the Massachusetts Resettlement Service Program, a support program, MRSP. And those funds are for Ukrainians and other displaced populations. So the International Institute and other resettlement providers in the state, we are using that funding to help Haitians. We're using state funding to help Haitians. Mm-hmm. We need more federal funding to help Haitians. And Dr. Gabeau is 100% correct. They are not getting the same support. And the important thing to recognize is that, you know, this state lost 110,000 people since the start of the pandemic. Now we have people coming into the state of Massachusetts who are fleeing a humanitarian crisis, but every single one of them that I meet, every adult that I meet, wants to work. They want to work. They want to get into the workforce. They want to make some money. They're willing to work one job, two jobs, three jobs. They're willing to take jobs that no one else wants right now. And so we need these people. We should be not only embracing them from a humanitarian perspective, but excited about them being here, because we've lost population and we need people to join our Commonwealth.
But isn't there a barrier, a ban on them actually working, and that's something that could potentially change?
It depends on their legal status. So if they're paroled into the country, they can get an employer authorization document. We have assigned one attorney on our staff to work with Haitians to get them employer authorization documents as fast as possible. It can take a couple of months. It just depends on the circumstances of their status. So if they get an employer authorization document, they can get into the economy and get a job and make some money. Another challenge that folks face, whether they're from Ukraine or Afghanistan or Haiti or any other country, is learning English. We have English classes, but we have huge waiting lists for our English classes. all groups that do this kind of work need more funding from the state of Massachusetts to offer more English classes to people that want to come here, work, and contribute.
Okay. To a point that both of you made about federal assistance, Boston Mayor Michelle Wu's office put out a statement that read in part, the city and state need the federal government to provide the necessary support to deal with this crisis by increasing their capacity to issue work permits to asylum seekers, providing additional funding to provide support services throughout a community-centered approach, better coordinating with states and cities on anticipated arrivals, and establishing clear protocols for the Department of Homeland Security personnel to return all documents to migrants upon release. Dr. Gabeau, can you speak to that, about the need for the federal government here to step in?
Exactly. First, it takes months and sometimes a full year for someone who apply for work authorization to receive it. And that's the reason why the burden is on us is heavier, because when you are helping someone for a couple of months, hoping that they will receive their work authorization and they don't, it means that you have to spend more time, you know, providing for them, when in fact, there is a way for work authorization to be coming out quickly. They did that for the Afghan. They did it for the Ukrainian. Some of them received their work authorization in less than a week. Our people are waiting a year to get work authorization. That's one of the reasons why the federal government needs to step up to at least release those work authorizations to allow people to go to work. And from the border, so often we find people coming with no documents or with confusing documents. We have people who come with 1 day of parole or 1 week of parole. So all of those confusion, and sometimes they hold documents from people, which means that by the time that they are in our community, they cannot do much because they need those documents. So those are all of the things that the mayor is referring to in terms of, you know, working in collaboration with both, you know, city, state, and also community-based organization, so we have a comprehensive approach toward welcoming our brothers and sisters.
Okay. Jeff, in just the minute we have left here, what can regular people watching this do? Is there anything they can do to help with this?
Well,
situation?
I think Dr. Gabeau said it. One, they can contribute to either one of our organizations or any organization working with Haitians. Two, if they have places for people to live, they have an extra home and extra room in their house, if they have a part of their house they're not using, they should contact one of our organizations because people need places to live. They can contribute food, they can contribute clothing, they can volunteer for English classes. There's a lot of things that people can do to help out. We need, and they can also advocate. So it's really important. We've had a lot of success and a lot of outpouring of support for Afghans and Ukrainians. Well-deserved, no doubt about it. But also they can advocate to the legislators, to Congress, to our leaders, that Haitians need support. Haitians bring a lot of potential to this state. And we want these people to come and stay and be part of the Commonwealth.
Okay.
Exactly. And time, they can contribute their time, because so often they are here, they need to go to the hospital, they need to access, you know, services. People can come and help. Like this Saturday, we have a day of service with, a number of people coming to help us, okay, so that we can serve those people. We are bringing all the people from the shelter for a day of service to help them, so they can come and help.
Well, we have to leave it there. Dr. Geralde Gabeau and Jeff Thielman, thank you both so much for joining us tonight.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Our pleasure. Thank you.